Hello, you multi manual exposed setting photographs. Bit of a long-winded malt mention, but it's still a malt mention because it begins with M. And thank you to Sebastian for that malt mention. Introducing Whiskey Review 362, part 5 of a series, part of a series of Canadian spirits, and part of a recent, I'll ties in with a recent invitation I had to the Spirit of Toronto Whiskey Gala in Toronto, Ontario. Interesting city to visit, and like most cities, one of the best and fastest ways to learn all about it and get the flavour, catch the flavour, is just to walk round the streets looking and listening and learning. Travel's a wonderful thing, by the way. And you don't actually have to go somewhere to travel. You know, there's certain programmes on television or certain stuff on YouTube or Vimeo or whatever you're watching or listening to. It can take you on a journey. Life's a journey. Anyway, let's journey towards Still Waters Distillery, somewhere on the outskirts of Toronto. It's a very small distillery. It's only producing 2 barrels a week of whiskey. So not a lot. And there's 2 chaps, 2 proprietors looking after the place, Barry and Barry. And they've been producing some vodka, and they're also looking at producing a few different things to accompany their whiskey, but mainly their focus is now on barley malt whiskey. Interesting, because it's a sign of the times. Little micro distilleries, very small production, and a bit of a gamble, to be honest, because there's an awful lot of capital involved in setting up a distillery, and then distillers have to play the waiting game while the spirit matures, and then find out if it has really got that sort of identity and matured quality that is going to attract ongoing sales, repeat sales. Very important for any business. You always have the honeymoon period when you've got a small distillery. You get the sympathy sales and the first sales, the virgin sales. But the real success comes when you get continued sales. And I think it's going to happen for Still Waters, because it's a very full-bodied, rich, new-make spirit. Now, they've already brought out in 2012 a tall bottle of blended whiskey, which involved not only their own produced whiskey, but they were blending it with whiskies from other distilleries. And to their credit, they're making it quite clear in the back of the label that they're doing that. So fair game, fair dues. Business is business. However, they're now bottling their very young whiskey as stock and barrel, single malt. This is cask number two, bottle number 48, bottled at 61.3%. Now, it is extremely rare to get any Canadian spirit at that strength. And as you and I know, malt mates, the stronger the alcohol, the more capacity for flavour. So I'm going to just kind of review this in the context that it is a young whiskey. I'm not going to be glamorising it. I'm going to be fairly kind of honest about it, and it will be reflected in the mark. But I think that this is a distillery that's going to be well worth watching, because although the United States of America has got a lot of small craft distilleries, Canada doesn't. And it's definitely the case that in a northern location, a northern climate, you will get the provenance of situation which is more akin to Scotland and Scotch whiskey maturation. So it'll be interesting to see how this little Canadian distillery gets on. And incidentally, I'll just mention it, the next vlog after this, 362 part 6 is an interview with Barry and Barry, the proprietors, on location at the distillery, so you can actually see the place for yourself. Well, part of it. Anyway, a roll in the glass, 61.3, we will be adding water shortly. Very rich, rather intense, slightly fresh fruit, hint of overripe pineapple, English mustard, certainly, and ginger. Candy fruit, vanilla oil. Plenty of water in this. Let's bring it down a bit. Interesting to note the kind of haziness you get when you put the water in the whiskey. The viscosity, it's called. Because the more viscous and kind of thread-like the viscosity, then the more naturally presented the whiskey is. It's got more of the barley oils intact. So that's a good sign, that. More floral coming through in the nose. Now, my nose is still a bit stuffied up with the cold, by the way. So I'm having to fake this a little bit. I'm not actually getting much. When I say faking, I'm not really. It's written down. I wrote down the notes when I reviewed this before the cold arrived. So I'm kind of more or less relying on my notes rather than what I'm actually smelling here, which isn't a lot at the moment. But we're getting there. English roses, English cabbage roses. There's a producer of English roses called David Austin who produces some fantastic full-flowered varieties. Particularly his climbers are really marvellous if you happen to be a rose gardener. And I'm getting the smell of them, a complex rose oil, rose water smell. Honey, daffodil, cream soda, certainly fruity cream soda, and a complex vanilla again. Taste, it's a bit better than my nose. Oh, it's young, very young spirit, an awful lot of new make about it, and it's still very much in its infancy, but you've got that grappa like character to the whiskey, which can be very interesting in its own way. So I've got a kind of unsettled ginger, pineapple and slight chilli, mixed sweets, mint, mustard, grappa and pear. Slightly unripe pear. And with water, you'll get more fresh fruit, mixed fresh fruits, toffee apple and a gingery mustard barley grain. Not particularly grainy malt, but there is a hint of grain in with the fruit. The finish, vanilla, sourwood, fresh fruit, and a growing, slightly soured grain. So, it's got a bit of a way to go yet, but it's a good start for this whisky. So the marks, and I've got to be realistic because it is young whisky, 81 out of 100. I was going to say blend, because I've been referring to Canadian whiskies as blend, but this is a malt whisky, so it's a malt. That's a malt mark. Right. They do have the ability, the opportunity to, because of the heavy liquor control situation in Ontario, and I know Canadians are grumbling a lot about the LCBO, and to be honest, I don't blame you, because in visiting Ontario and seeing the amount of legislative control on the sale of liquor, it really makes me appreciate just the variety that we've got in offer and the availability in Britain. You know, we tend to moan about the place where we are, but lucky us in the UK, particularly with online sales, it's just opened things up completely, the variety of what we can buy. So we're very fortunate in that respect. So hopefully things will improve for you Canadians out there. You've got to write to your representatives collectively. Keep pushing. But in the meantime, the distillery is able to sell some of their whiskey from their actual unit, production unit. So have a look at the website, Still Waters Distillery, Toronto. Find it in Google. and it'll be interesting to see how this little distillery gets on. And it's a challenge because moving on from this review, it gives me an opportunity to mention that it may seem a wonderful idea to start your own distillery, but it really can be heavy going in the early years, the formative years, because you're constantly putting money into finance production and you've got big capital costs, your stills, your grain, your yeast, your barrels, your messaging, your branding, your bottles, the labels. There's a lot involved, more than meets the eye. All the legal hurdles, the regulations, and regulations regarding alcohol can be an absolute minefield at times, depending which country you're in. So please don't start a distillery going in blind, because it may seem a kind of a romantic notion and a desirable thing to have your own distillery. Who wouldn't like their own distillery? But there's a big, big difference from the actual responsibility and the sacrifice of owning one, where occasionally you get to sit down with the anoraks and maybe enjoy a whiskey or two. Those are relatively few and far between moments. But that's what we tend to see when we're visiting distilleries. But distilleries, it's a, even a small distillery, it's an awful lot of capital involved and a lot of belief and faith that your product, when it matures, is going to catch people's attention. A small distillery can be flexible, can produce young white spirits which will sell literally shortly after production. Vodka is the obvious example, but probably gins are more successful, more interesting, because you can play around with the botanicals ratio of gins to create something that's genuinely individual and characterful, and people will go for that. But having thought quite long about it, what advice would I give a small distillery? In 5 seconds, a 5 second answer would be quite simply quality, quality, quality. Now, speaking to some experienced brewers recently, who are saying that the biggest mistake someone can make when they're starting out is not to get their product right before hitting the market, not to have the quality control protocols and procedures in place to assure the continuity of the product. That is so important for anything, because increasingly we're now entering an age of intolerance where people have had an experience and exposure to different spirits over the years. And when people are becoming disappointed with what they perceive as a fall in the quality, people are just dumping brands. It's actually happening. They're saying, you know, I'm not brand loyal. I'm quality loyal. So I'm just going to jump ship. And that's happening now more than ever before. So it's something that every distiller needs to be aware of. And that situation can be kind of masked in a time when there's good going sales and we're told it's a boom time for whiskey sales. It's not as boomy as we're led to believe. It's a bit more selectively boomy, if you know what I mean. But back to small distilleries. Quality, quality and quality. It's your self-imposed apprenticeship of getting your stills, getting to know your stills, and particularly with small stills, you can never to be too far away when these stills are running. Even a phone call in the office that goes on 5 minutes too long, you go back out to your stills. An experienced stillman can hear from the still that the cut's kind of getting a bit too long. You know, you're getting too far into the faints. You know, small stills need to be watched. So you're talking a lot of hours involved. And also, no matter what the quality of your new make and the quality of your casks, and cask quality is so important, you need to invest the money in that right from the first day. But you never know what your final result's going to be until you're a few years down the line. You may be fortunate, like Amrit, that at an early age, because of the provenance of location and with the sacrifice of evaporation from the casks, that you end up with a really tasty whiskey in 2 or 3 or 4 years. But particularly in the Northern Hemisphere, you know, and particularly in Canada, you know, the whiskey is going to take longer to mature because of the provenance of location and the long cold winters. That can be a good thing, but it's a long, hard slog, and you gotta learn fast. And it is, as I say, it's however you define it. And listen to the anoraks, and make sure you've got a good active web page that kind of can interact with your fan base, your malt, the malt heads, the whiskey clubs, and get your feedback from people. Even when feedback isn't flattering, it's actually better for you, because the worst thing is everybody bumping on about how great your whiskey is when in fact it's not that great, but they just want to say nice things because they're getting a free sample. So the responsibility of whiskey clubs and visitors to distillery is be respectful, be civil, but be honest as well. Always give an honest opinion and always keep it in context. And again, for small distillers, once you've got the product, it doesn't end there. It's getting an individual and characterful packaging presentation, particularly in the bottle. Not so much the wrapping around the bottle, that's important, but the bottle itself. Even if you have to spend a wee bit more in the bottle, or you do what Stock and Barrel have done, a distinctive circular black label, so that kind of it's a bit of a feature, so that it can't be mistaken for another brand. That's important. And something worth considering is using the online medium, because it's cheap. It's cheap for me to do. I'm only about on $200 for all my equipment. You know, the camera, the tripod, the sound system. It's a bit ropey. Of course it is. But people don't mind that, so long as the content is original, engaging, entertaining and reasonably informative. And that's the challenge for a small distillery, is to fire up your website so as it's noticed. And if you want a good example of a small distillery which is really using their website, all singing, all dancing, whistles and bells, have a look at Balcones in Texas. Balcones Distillery. They're really doing it from a very contemporary and successful perspective. But one final piece of advice is, a lot of people are now drinking whiskey at home, in the house. And one reason why I tend to get a reasonable amount of traffic, and thank you for watching everybody, appreciated, is because if you're not in a pub, and if you're not with friends, or you're with a few friends, and you're not sure about a whiskey, where's the place you're going to find out? You can go to the official websites, but they tend to be an orthodox marketing message, which is understandable, because distillation's a business. But people want a little bit of feedback, engagement, connection with, whether it be myself because I'm experienced and eccentric, or whether it be yourself if you've got a small distillery. If you can put a little bit of your location and your philosophy and your personality and really feed that strongly into your website, then that will certainly reinforce the experience of the whiskey that you've sold when people are checking you out online. And you can fire that up for a relatively small cost. A little bit of Ralphie advice. It's all free, guys. It's all free for you small distillers. Get yourself a big box of plug-in USB ports, sticks, USB memory sticks. 4 gig, 4 megabyte should just do it fine. And what to do is record some scenery at your distillery, record some music at your distillery, or just record your distillery working, so that when people open a bottle of your whiskey, they can lift off the USB memory stick from round the neck of the bottle, or lift it off the top of the cork of the bottle, stick it into the computer, and they can have an audio visual experience of your distillery to go with the whiskey that they have bought. It's not getting done, and it's so easy to do. It doesn't have to be super slick. In fact, it's better if it's not. But Kodak ZI-8, excellent little camera, can be a slightly ropey in the quality of light adjustment. A perfectly standard microphone can be a little bit boomy at times, but you know, that's real life and we get on with it. I'm not the BBC. And with a little bit of experience and practice, you know, there's no reason why a small distiller can't just walk, march straight up to the camera in the still room and say, by the way, guys, we've just made some more whiskey and we're just bottling another batch of whiskey soon. And this is what we think it tastes like. And, you know, when you buy a bottle, few tasting notes, but we made it in this month. And this is the kind of barley we used, and this is the amount of yeast we used, and this is the kind of barrels we used. In fact, here's a barrel. We'll show you the barrel we matured your whiskey in. This is it. It came from such and such a distillery, and we had a wee bit of so much evaporation. See all that information. Whiskey anoraks love it. Just love it. So there you are. Some Ralphie advice. Take it or leave it. It's for free. All for free. And it's been a great opportunity to kind of connect a few ideas for small distilleries around the world with still waters and their stock and barrel bottling, because they're exactly in that position, being a very small distillery. So we're wishing them good luck. Good luck to Barry and Barry. They'll be coming along soon to tell you themselves about their whiskey in the next vlog. Fantastic. Isn't the information age fabulous? Oh, I feel sorry for the Victorians and Edwardians and all the rest of it. Their access to information was so restricted. And goodness knows what it's going to be like in the future. Cheers.